Hi everyone, in this video I'm going to walk you through step-by-step how to deploy a Node.js Azure function that's connected to your RavenDB database. Before we start, I'm going to assume you're already familiar with Azure Functions and are using RavenDB in some capacity. You'll also need an Azure account and your RavenDB client certificate to connect, and a GitHub account. You'll also need Node and Azure Function Core tools installed to be able to use the runtime locally. I use Visual Studio Code in the demo, but you can use whatever editor you prefer, as long as you have Git installed locally and can push to GitHub. In case you get stuck, there is a how-to guide you can follow. Just see the link below that provides more details. Let's get started. To find the RavenDB Azure Functions template if you don't already have it, head to github.com/ravendb/templates. The templates repository hosts starters and templates for RavenDB. Find the Node Azure template you want to deploy, and then click the Deploy to Azure button. This opens up the Azure Deployment Wizard that sets your Azure Function resources up for a dynamic consumption plan as opposed to an app service-based plan. If you want more control or you'd prefer to use the command line, there is a manual process which is provided in the written companion to the video. This deployment wizard is probably the easiest way to get started though. First, start by picking a resource group or creating a new one, which is what I'm going to do since I'll be deleting these resources after the demo. Next, you'll see the deployment template has special syntax in these different parameters that compute names for the different resources, like the function app name and storage account name. You could either leave these alone or customize them now to names you'd prefer instead. I'll leave them at the defaults. Next, click Review, and then click Create to start the deployment. Once the deployment finishes, you'll see the function app has been created. However, if you go to the functions URL, we only see the Azure Functions welcome screen. This wizard only sets up the Azure resources. It does not do any kind of code deployment, and that's what we're going to do next. We'll set up continuous integration using the RavenDB template. So, on the overview blade, click the Get Publish Profile button as we're going to need that soon. Next, we need to clone the RavenDB template from GitHub. On this page, there's a clone template command you can copy. I'll go into my terminal and paste it. It's a bit long, but it essentially clones a subdirectory of the repository and resets the repository state. I'm going to change the directory name from my project to something else, then I'll run it. And now we've got a brand new repository initialized with the RavenDB template. I'll run npm install to make sure all our dependencies are in order, then add all the files to Git and create an initial commit. I'll also open the folder up in VS Code so we have it ready for the next step. Now we need a repository to push this to, so back in GitHub, I'll create a new repository, give it a name, and fill out all these details. Before we push to this new repo, we need to set it up for GitHub Actions, so I'll go into the Settings, and then into the Secrets and Variables area, because we need a secret to store the publish profile in order to do the deployment. The secret name is in the workflow file, so I'll go back to VS Code, and then under the .github folder, there's a workflows folder and the deploy.yaml template. And down below is the secret name, so I'll copy that and then paste it back into the interface in GitHub for the new secret. The value is going to be the contents of that publish XML file we downloaded earlier, so I'll open that inside of VS Code, copy everything inside, and paste that back into the value of the secret in GitHub. And that should be all we need for GitHub Actions to work. Next, I'll go back to the repository homepage and copy the commands to push an existing local repository to the new Git remote. I'll go back to VS Code, paste it into the terminal, and push. If everything works, we should see a new deployment kickoff under the GitHub Actions in the repo. If the deployment finishes successfully, that means the app got deployed. If it failed, check the job logs to see what the error might be. Double-check the secret name and its value if it's a permission-related issue. For other issues, see the troubleshooting docs linked below. Let's verify the function now. If I go back to the browser tab and refresh, it's still going to show me the welcome page because our function is an API endpoint. Back in the Azure portal, I'll go to the functions list and it looks like our HTTP trigger function is there. I'll click into that and then click Get Function URL, which will get me the full URL I can use to test. I'll go back to the tab, paste it in, and we'll see what we get. Awesome! We're greeted with the welcome screen, so it looks like the function is working. Right now, you can see that the function is connecting to the live test instance of RavenDB. And what you probably want is to connect it to your own instance. In order to do that, we have to update the app settings in two different places, locally and within Azure. Let's start local. In VS Code, I'll open up the local.settings.json file. You can see that there are a few settings prefixed with db underscore, including the URLs and database name. In this demo, I'm going to use RavenDB Cloud, so you would have to get the same connection information and certificates from your own instance if you need to use the self-hosted version. I've opened up my RavenDB Cloud dashboard here, and I have the cluster URLs. Those can be copied, which I'll paste back into the URLs app setting. If you have multiple nodes in the cluster, the URLs have to be comma separated within the string. The other value to update is db underscore name, which is the default database to connect to in your cluster. You do want to make sure that this database exists, otherwise you're going to get an error when you try to run this later. Now we need to handle authentication with client certificates. There are three primary ways to do this: using a physical certificate file, using environment variables, or using Azure Key Vault. I'll show you how to use both the physical file and environment variables in this demo. While Azure Key Vault would be the most secure method, it costs extra and is covered in the documentation if you'd like to use that. Okay, so first we need to get our client certificate so that we can use it locally and on Azure. So we'll go back in the cloud dashboard, click the download certificate button, which opens up a modal, and you can click the download client certificate package button to download a package containing the client certificates we can use to connect. This is a cluster certificate and has very wide permissions to allow you to manage the cluster. For production, it would be better to generate a specific client certificate with more limited access. But for this demo, it doesn't really matter which certificate you use as long as it has access to the database. Once the package is downloaded, extract it to an easy-to-access location, but take care not to accidentally extract it inside the repo because not all the files are password protected. There are a few files we will need for the next steps, but we'll start with the PFX file without a password. This is what will let us connect to RavenDB on our local machine. We want to keep it outside the project repository, so we'll need to copy the path. On Windows, Shift-right-click will show a Copy as Path option we can use. On other platforms, you'll have to copy the path manually. Next, I'll update the local settings JSON, which will only be used in our local development environment. I'll set the db cert path to the absolute path I copied to the PFX file. This could be a relative path as well. If you do intend to use the password protected PFX, you would have to use another setting, db underscore cert underscore password. I don't recommend adding it to this file because it will be committed to source control. You would either have to remove this file from Git, then ignore it, or export an environment variable in your bash profile or PowerShell profile so that it stays out of Git. Okay, this should be all we need locally, so I'll start the function and we'll try opening the browser to see if the connection is working. Awesome, it's connected. Now we have to make it work on Azure. I'll commit my changes and push them. This should trigger a new deployment which we'll need to wait for. Once it finishes successfully, I'll go back to the deployed Azure Functions URL and hit refresh. Well, it says it's still connecting to the live test instance of RavenDB. Why is that? Well, it's because we're actually overriding the app settings in the Azure portal, and we haven't configured our production certificate yet. Let's go take a look. In the portal, with our Azure Functions app open, I'll go to the configuration blade. If I scroll down, you'll see some app settings listed here. These variables map directly to the ones in the JSON file. We'll edit all three of these settings. First, let's update the DB URLs and DB name. I'll click to show what the value is right now. Then I'll click Edit, type in the values, and save the changes. Now we'll update this DB cert PEM variable. Remember, we are only using the PFX file locally, so we need a way to pass the production certificate information when deployed to Azure. The easiest way to do that is by using the PEM-encoded certificate containing the public-private key pair. I'll find and copy the contents of the .pem file from the PEM folder we downloaded earlier where we extracted the client certificates and paste it into the text box. You'll notice the line endings seem to disappear, but this is okay and should still work. Now save the settings to restart the function app with our changes. Okay, here's the finale. Did it work? Let's find out. Going back to the function URL and refreshing, yes, we are connected to our RavenDB cloud cluster. The last thing I'll show you is how to clean up the Azure resources, especially if you don't intend to use them, so they don't incur extra costs. Back in the portal, going to the Overview blade, you could simply stop the app. Now, if you're using the app service plan instead of the consumption plan, you're still going to incur costs since that's reserved compute. Just to be safe, I'm going to go ahead and remove everything by clicking the resource group, and then I'll click Delete Resource Group, which you'll need to confirm. Once you do, Azure will remove all the resources we just created using the deployment template at the start of the video. To learn more about using RavenDB with Azure Functions, there are links to resources below, and we look forward to hearing about all the cool stuff you're building. Thanks.